Well, good evening, everyone. Good evening. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm already at the SharePoint party at the end of the day. My name is Albert Hoyting. Welcome to this session. It's going to be about Azure Information Protection, the ins and outs, as I called it. Just a small info on myself. Like I said, my name is Albert. I work as a business consultant at Sogety, mostly on Office 365, but the last couple of years, I have been specializing in all stuff related to information protection. I have a couple of objectives for today. In the next 45 minutes, I'll be talking about Azure Information Protection. So when you leave the room, I hope that you know at least the basics of how it works from a user perspective, but also from the management perspective. So I'm going to show that to you. In Ignite last September, the roadmap was announced for Azure Information Protection, and I'm probably going to abbreviate that to AIP because it takes a bit of time to pronounce that every time. So the AIP roadmap. So I'm going to talk about that as well. And in the end, I'll have some tips or approaches on how to implement AIP within the organization. Okay, but let's start at the beginning. Why do we need information protection? And if we want to answer that question, we'll have to go a little bit back in the past and look at how in the past we had our environment. We had a very secure environment, basically, because we had a perimeter, which was our firewall, and within that perimeter we had all our apps, our devices, our data, our users, and everything was managed. And it was very secure, and if you wanted to go outside of that perimeter, you had to be allowed to have access through that firewall. So everything was very nice, very manageable, no problems. But it's become a little more complex right now. We all know the cloud. Everybody's either using Office 365, Google, Dropbox, you name it. We've got a lot of applications. We've got a lot of data as well, and we've got a lot less boundaries right now. Just one question. Is there anyone in the room here who works for an organization who does not allow access to the internet for their users? I've worked with companies who did have that. I'm not sure if they already changed that, but there's probably still organizations who do that. But you have that that cloud. And just one little sidestep right now. Just a show of hands. In 2014, Business Insider did a survey, and they surveyed a lot of things, and one of the things was the number of Office documents which were created in that year, 2014. So, just a show of hands, how many documents do you think were created, Office documents? Let's start at 50 million. Someone? Okay, more than 50 million, let's say 200 million. Nope, no. 500 million, perhaps? Still, okay, then let's up the ante. 1 billion. 1 billion documents created. Okay, some. Okay. 15 billion, perhaps. 15. Okay, now we're talking. Let's say 50 billion documents. How many think were created? Okay. Well, I'll just carry on. The research concluded there were more than 500 billion documents created in 2014 alone. That number is growing exponentially right now, and it's just an indication of the complexity we're dealing with right now. By the way, the number of PDF documents in that same year went into the trillions. So just to give an small scale example of the complexity. Okay, those are some of the reasons you might need information protection. There are others. Let's look at three of them. First of all, you might have compliance regulations you need to adhere to. Probably most of you know the GDPR right now, the General Data Protection Regulation, which is going into effect in next May. That might force you to look at information protection. There may be other things like letting your information and knowledge workers have some awareness on the content they're creating and sharing and working with. So that might be another reason to look at information protection. And the sharing of information. Sharing information is only increasing. We're working with the marketing department is working with an external company for their new logo, or you're working with an HR company, or so the sharing of information is becoming more and more frequent and easy. Look at things like Office 365. Just share and off you go. So, but you don't know what's going to be shared, so you need to protect that information. Okay. Now let's look at the Microsoft stack. If we're looking at Microsoft, we have a lot of different ways to protect your information. And those range from your workstation, which you can protect, of course, with Windows 10 and the Edge browser and all sorts of other nice things. The EMS suite, Enterprise Mobility and Security, so you can have control over the devices which are going to your environment. Office 365 also has a lot of options right now. The Security and Compliance Center, Data Loss Prevention, the Cloud App Security Model. It's more or less like a puzzle of which you need to, which all the pieces are provided to you, but you need to complete that puzzle. And one of those pieces is Azure Information Protection. And that's what this session is about. Okay. Azure Information Protection. To put it very, well, in a very short time frame, it's basically four pillars of functions. You can detect content or the sensitivity of the content. You can classify the content based on that detection. You can protect the content, and you can monitor its use. And basically, that's the whole life cycle of information protection over there. So let's look at two of the more important pillars of that AIP functionality, and that's classification and protection. First of all, labels, the classification of your content. AIP uses labels for that, and you can label your content. And a label can be highly confidential, or a label could be HR material, or a label could be don't share this outside of the organization. At Ignite, one of the demos was by a banking firm, Quicken Loans, and they basically have three labels, green, orange, and red, and they're basically ranging from it's okay to share to don't share, and the orange one is in the middle, of course. So that's very basic way to label your information. The classification can be done manually. I'll just show that in a demo in a couple of minutes. But you can also have automatic labeling, which means that Azure is going to look through your content and see if some conditions are met. For example, there's a license plate, a license number in there, or there's an IBAN, an international banking number in there, or there is some other personal identifiable information within that content, and it then can apply automatically the labels which are associated with that content. It wouldn't be Microsoft if there's a licensing aspect to that, so you will need the more expensive licensing for that automatic labeling. Protecting. When we're talking about protecting the content, then we're talking about rights management, encryption. If I want to share something with you, then I'm going to place you in the to field, for example, of an email, and then the content is going to be encrypted based on your rights, for example. Which means that if you want to use the encryption, the protection of Azure Information Protection, you need two things. You need rights management, and you're going to need Active Directory, or Azure Active Directory, because the encryption is based on identities. Well, you can have multiple options for using the Active Directory. You can either be already in sort of like native Active Directory, or you can have a Active Directory connector connecting to your on-premise Active Directory. That really isn't any problem, but you do need that Active Directory account. Okay, so let's say I'm starting to share something with you and you don't have an Active Directory account. You only have a Gmail account, for example, and that's basically it, okay? Then there's no big problem, because if you want to share something with people outside of an Active Directory, those people can request a temporary, or more or less temporarily, Active Directory account by Microsoft. And that account is created in a tenant by Microsoft, and you get an Active Directory account to use with rights management. In the end of the story, I will be going into the roadmap, and one of the things which was on the roadmap and has already been introduced into production is Office 365 message encryption. And why do I name that specifically? Because that enables you now to share information with, for example, a Gmail user, and they can really use their Gmail account to log in to get to that content. If you want to know anything about that, contact me after the session, because I'll be here after the session as well. Okay, before I go into the demo, like I said, you can protect your content, which means you can set policies like do not print, do not copy, do not forward, and you can have some deviations in those policies. And those policy and those protection policies can be linked to the labels you're using. Okay, let's take a look. My first demo will be Office 2016 combined with, here it is, combined with Azure Information Protection. And well, this is simply Word, and one of the things you'll probably notice is I have here a little protect button. And this protection button, this is the Azure Information Protection or AIP client, which is integrated now in Office. And what you see over here are those labels I talked about. I'll just show those labels in a couple of minutes from the ribbon as well, but this is from the client. And what you see over here is two options to set custom permissions. For example, I don't want to label this this information, but I do want to share it securely with an external person. Then I can set those permissions on that document. For example, do not print, do not forward, you name it. I can also track and trace or track and revoke. I also always call it track and trace because, well, basically that's what it does. If I share it with someone, like for example with you or a document with you, no problem. I can go to the track and trace portal of RMS, and then I can see where the document has been opened, by whom, and when. And if I see something suspicious, like I see the same document being opened by one user ID at two different and very different locations, for example, one in Europe and one in Asia, I can revoke access to that document. And that's by track and revoke. But let's look at those labels. Over here I have one that says personal. And why is that personal? Because one of the things I prearranged in my policy is to have a default label. And this one is labeled personal. So every content I try to save will have that personal label attached. There's no protection right now, it's just a label. By the way, those labels are added to the document, so that or to the content, no matter where the content is stored. So either it could be in SharePoint, it could be on a file share, it could be in SAP, doesn't matter. The content is always provided with a label based on the content. So right now this has the label personal. If I want to change that, that's no problem. I can go to public, and well, there you have it, public. Well, sure, no problem. I go from a less delicate level to a more delicate level. But what if I go back? Let's say I change that back to personal. Okay. Now Azure Information Protection will ask me, okay, please provide me with a reason. Why are you changing from a higher to a lower level? And this is one of the functions I also set up in my policy. Right now, I only have two. Okay, no longer applies, and I confirm that. You might wonder, okay, what's happening now? What happens next? I mean, what if I have a lot of people who go into Word, see that default label, and figure, well, I don't need that. I just change it back, or I delete it as a whole, and I just say, okay, no longer applies. Well, the action I just took will be logged in the event viewer of the workstation. So Albert has downgraded to personal. And Microsoft is one of the things they have on their roadmap right now is to have some sort of administration portal for that. Because you probably want to know how many people are doing that or and why are they doing that and probably need to prevent that. But that's not at the moment possible. Okay, what if I go to a more secure thing? I have a couple of labels and I'll show them in the management console in a couple of minutes. Which do have protection, and I go to HR Vertrouwelijk, that's a highly confidential. And right now you see, Word has added a footer. Sorry, a header, of course. The footer is also there. Yeah, there it is. And if you want to, you can also add a watermark, for example. Those are what we call the visual markings of the document. And well, just to open state the obvious, those can't be modified by the user, of course. Those are really added to the document. What has also happened is that this document is now protected. And to show you what happens if I open a protected document, I have to switch to another document, because Azure IP will allow you as an owner of the document to always access the document. So even though I have protected it, I won't be able to show you the protection. So I'll just go to a other document, and that's this one. This is a very sensitive document. It states in Dutch. And I've opened this document, but I don't have all the rights to this document. And let's see if I have the permission and what you see over here. I can, well, I'll just read it from here, that's better. I can view it, but I can't edit, copy, print, or whatever, because I don't have the rights. This document has been encrypted using that label and using that policy, and has been shared with me, but I can't open it anymore. Okay, let's go back to the example I had over here, because you might have noticed that it contains a lot of IBAN numbers, because, well, basically I went to a site which has all those default IBAN numbers and copy-paste them into the document. And I also have a policy which detects IBAN numbers, IBAN numbers. So let's see if that works. Always a nice check, of course. I'll just try to save it, and it says, oh, you might want to reconsider your label right now, because we detected some content and you might want to change it to the other one. So, well, in this case, I can dismiss it. Again, that's a policy setting I've created. So if I don't want to, I can really force my users to change it, but in this case, I just ask them. Okay, let's change it right now. And here we go, we have our little different header right now. I also have a watermark over here, and I have there it is. I also have a footer, and of course the protection is enabled, which I just showed you in the other document. So this is the automatic detection. You might notice that I had to save the document for AIP to really apply that. One of the things Microsoft is currently rolling out is a more or less real-time detection. So if I type in a passport number and there is a label associated with that, then it's going to prompt me for the label. But that's not the case right now. Okay, before I go on, I'll just want to show you one other thing. This is from Office. The AIP client, which you can install, also works within the file system. So let's say I have a PowerPoint over here, and I choose Classify and Protect. It will pop up the Azure Information Protection client. And over here, you'll see the same labels I already had. And let's say I'll just mark this document as a secret. And if I go, and there it is. Now this document has been protected, labeled and protected by AIP. And if I just refresh this, that's a pity. That's one of the things which I think it's a pity. In AIP, if you protect and label Office documents, it really integrates within Office. If you protect or label and or protect any other type of document, like a PDF or a text document or whatever, or CAD/CAM, it also changes the icon of the file. There's a little AIP logo then combined with that file. But because I now use the PowerPoint document, it won't show. That's a pity. Okay. That's the functional side of Azure Information Protection. And let's move on. Before I go into the management side of AIP, just a couple of considerations. First of all, anyone here know about the Office 365 data governance labels? Okay, well, data governance labels has been introduced, I think it was like a half year ago, and those are used for setting expiration dates, retention policies, you name it, on content which is in Office 365. One problem with that, it works like a charm, but it's also called labels. So now you had AIP labels and you had data governance labels. During Ignite, it was announced that those are going to be merged into one solution for Office 365. So we're going to have one labeling solution for that. Another takeaway for this, working with SharePoint and AIP. How many of you are using SharePoint for storing documents and sharing documents? Okay. Well, be my guest and try AIP and try to store some documents in a SharePoint library. You're going to be, well, somewhat surprised, I guess. First of all, AIP and SharePoint IRM, Information Rights Management, don't work together. So they're different technologies and they don't work together. Probably the product teams don't work together either, because I asked some of the product team members at Ignite some things and the AIP guys were like, what's SharePoint and vice versa. But anyway, that's going to be, they're going to solve that, I was promised. So one of the other things, if you store an AIP document and it's protected, labels isn't a problem, but if it's protected and you store it in SharePoint, some of the things won't work. For example, you won't get any previews of your document. You won't be able to use the web applications of SharePoint. You won't be able to use the real-time collaboration functions. So you won't be able to work within that same document, basically because SharePoint can't decrypt that document for you. So you need to take that into account. SharePoint solved that for themselves, by the way. They are using AIP, they also have labels. They have a setting, one of the labels is highly confidential, which encrypts and protects, or protects and encrypts the documents for them. And there's one sub-label there, and that's to be used for SharePoint, because then it won't be encrypted. So they have they created a little backdoor for themselves, by the way. You can have your labels syncing with SharePoint. You need to have some configuration for that, but you can have your labels, like internal or highly confidential, and have that as metadata within your SharePoint library. You can even have that working with AIP. So if I change the label from SharePoint library and I download the document, AIP will change that label for you. So you do have some form of integration with SharePoint and AIP. Okay, enough about that. Let's take a look at, okay, how do we manage those labels? How can we create them, etc. Okay, for this I need to go to Azure. And within Azure I have my Azure Information Protection Blade, which is open right now. And it displays a couple of things. First of all, where's the end of the stage? That might be useful to know. You have a global policy and you can have scoped policies. Well, the global policy, well, it's kind of obvious. That's the one that's, if you enable that, it's going to be applied to every user within the organization. Then you can have scoped policies, and those scoped policies, and it says something over here, you can have, like, for example, an HR department or management or, you name it, and the policy will only be applied to the people in those groups which are in those scoped policies. So that's, well, somewhat new right now. When it was first introduced, AIP, you only had the global policy, but right now you can also have scoped policies. Okay, what's in some policy? Well, that's on the right here. First of all, you have a name, description, etc. And yeah, then you have the labels, which we already saw within Office and in the File Explorer or Windows Explorer. And I'll go into that in a couple of minutes, but I just want to show you the other general settings of a policy. And those are the ones I already discussed. For example, user must provide a justification. If I set this to off, no problem, I can just change that label from high to low, no problem. It's still going to be into the log, in the event log, but I won't get a notification for that. I can have a default label. This is one, all documents and emails must have a label, which means if I start Word and I start typing away and I try to save the document, then I always will be prompted for a label. If I delete the label, I can just remove the label and I try to save the document again, it will prompt me for a label. I cannot save the document without a label. That's basically what this setting does over here. this one is relatively new. And also this little black thingy over here, that basically means buy an additional license, because that will work with email messages. One of the things I won't show you right now is the same function like in Word, but in Outlook, for example, where you can encrypt a document, encrypt the mail. So I just basically say do not forward, for example, and I send that mail to an external or an internal person, then the document or the mail will be protected. And one of the things Microsoft now introduced is a way to apply the label to the attachments as well. So if I send a mail and I have in that mail an attachment which is labeled highly confidential and I send it away like personal, this setting will automatically, or recommended either way, will set the highest level of classification for that entire email based on the highest confidentiality level which is in the attachments. Okay, if I want to show some more information on AIP, for example, a site for my service desk or whatever, I can have a custom URL here, and then if I just click on the help button, then I'm redirected to that location. Okay, these are general settings. These always apply. And let's look at let's create a new label, for example. Before I do that, you can have overall labels, the ones you see right behind me right now, and you can have sub-labels. You can also have sub-labels and which are the only ones who can be selected, and the higher level can't be selected, but that's a way to have some sort of hierarchy of your labeling. And just to round this off, what you see over here is the policy to which this label applies, which is the global one. Do I have a marking? The header, the footer, the watermark. Do I have a protection applied? Yes or no? And do I have a condition? And that condition, that's the automatic detection of sensitive information. Okay, I'll just create a label, and I'll just go over the label name, etc., because, well, that's not too relevant right now. But I want to show you the protection, for example. So if I choose to protect this, when this label is applied, I can set permissions. And what you see over here, I can either choose Azure, or if I already have an on-premise RMS environment, I can choose that, and then I also have to, then we're talking like a hybrid scenario where I have an on-premise Active Directory with rights management, policies, etc. I can use them, but I have to do some more configuration. So I'm just using the Azure one over here. I can add some permissions for that. For example, let me see. I'm going to use a user. Normally, you'll probably use groups, of course, for this, but I'll just I'll just select Peter for this. And what if this label has been? What if Peter gets a document which is protected by this label? What can he do with that document? Well, I more or less like those custom rights, so I'll just get those. And in my case, he can view and print the document. That's basically what I want him to do, to be able to do. If needed, I can also have content expiration, which means that I can set a date or a time when this content is going to expire. So, for example, let's say the 1st of November, which means that at the 1st of December, any access to this document will be closed off. And a user scenario for this might be, let's say you have you're working with partners and they want to work for you, so you set out a request for proposal, and you get but the information you supply with that request of proposal, you only want to be able only want to supply that for 2 weeks, for example, and then all access needs to be blocked. Well, you can use this kind of protection for that. Okay, one of the other options I also have within those labels is allow offline access. Can the document be downloaded, or can it only be read from the mail or from SharePoint, or you name it? So I say, that's not the case. I'm sorry about that. Allow offline access. That's basically how long can this content be available when someone downloads it. So that can be, for example, never allow it to be offline accessible. Okay, I save the protection. And okay, set visual markings. Those are the watermarks and the header and footer. I won't show them right now, but you probably can guess what's in there. You can have a font, you can have a color, you can have a text, etc. But what's more important is this one here, because that's the one used for automatically detecting your content. Remember where we are in the stage. I'm trying to create a label. I've got the protection in place. I've got the user which can access it. I know what he can do with the document. But now I need to have a condition. Once again, here's that little black thingy. So requires a P2 subscription. So yeah, we do need more licenses for that. But let's look at what the options are. Microsoft has already provided us with a lot of built-in, what they call sensitive types. And those sensitive types might be, for example, the Australia tax file number. Now, not for me, that's just an example. But if I select this one, then the system is going to look if there's any information regarding the Australia tax file numbers. I also wanted an Australia bank number in there. Oh, I can only have this one. Yeah, that's correct. Let's say I just have this one. Okay, so I'll save this because I have to have another connection if I want to have the banking number as well. Okay, and let's say I want to have a custom. Well, you can have your own custom sensitive types. For example, if you have specific metadata or specific expressions within your organization you want to use within those policies. So if you have those, you can have them over here. And then when you're done, let's discard this one because then basically we're all set for this label to become active. So I now have the Australia bank number, I have the tax file number. Okay, let's say I want to have that automatically applied. This is the tip I get when I have that automatically applied. And well, I have to save it. So let's say Australia. That's not the one. Yep. And because I'm very lazy, it's the same as the description. Okay. Yep, that's the one. I'll just close it. Oh, no. I want to save it first. Where's my save button? There. Weird. Okay, now I've saved my new label, but this label won't become active right away. One of the things you might notice, which is on the screen right now, is you need to publish it. And that's because the AIP client is in a kind of loop, always looking at new changes to the policy. And if those changes weren't published, the client won't pick them up. So I just say publish, okay. And now this label is going to be added. So if I would go back to Word in a couple of minutes, then there's going to be that Australia label. Okay. Those are basically the steps you want to take if you want to create those labels. If you want to look at those sensitivity types, by the way, Microsoft is going to introduce between now and a couple of weeks, I guess, 18 new ones. And those are basically all related to GDPR. So all kinds of sensitive types regarding personal identifiable information. So take a look at those as well. Okay. That's the management side of things. So we now know, okay, how does it work and how can I set those labels and all those little options I have. Let's say if you want to automate some of those functions you just saw. You've got two options for that. PowerShell has always been one of the options. The client, which is provided to you, already has several PowerShell commandlets for either scanning a folder, scanning a drive, protecting, labeling, etc. But that works from the user context. So the user who runs those commandlets, that's the one who's going to label, protect, etc. But it could be very helpful for getting an insight into your information. But what's being introduced at Ignite, and for those of you who might saw my little demo this morning, I did a demo on the stage, the open podium. The AIP scanner has now been in private preview for a couple of weeks or months. It's going to become available in public preview in the next couple of days. And that's a scanner which basically runs on a server. Again, looking for the things. That's going to be run on a server, and that's going to be able to, for example, continuously scan an environment, like file share, mostly on-premise environments, like file shares and SharePoint 2013 and 2016 environments. So it allows you to scan, it's going to allow you to label, to protect, and monitor basically your environment. So if you want to know what kind of information is stored within my organization, and does that contain any sensitive information, you can now use that AIP scanner when it becomes available. Okay, some tips on getting started. Well, I basically start with a pilot group, for example, and start using those default labels. It starts, well, basically small, because you won't be able to do this for the entire organization, let's say starting Friday and having it up and running Monday. Because we're talking rights, we're talking encryption, we're talking labeling. You're going to create a label taxonomy, basically. Most of the organizations already have that. I mean, well, let's check that. Any organization here using the CIA levels? None? Oh, one. Or two. Okay. So, I stand corrected then. But the confidentiality levels, like confidential, highly confidential, internal, etc. So you can use that as well as a basic starting point for your environment. Work with your workspace team for packaging those clients. They're very small clients, relatively speaking, but they need to be distributed to your workstations, of course, and you need to have some lifecycle management around that as well. Use recognizable labels, and really don't use any things like abbreviations or acronyms or things like PII or GDPR or whatever, because it needs to be related to your end users. They need to know what you mean with that. Like the example of Quicken Loans I used, they had three labels, and they really basically had the labels named Do Not Share, It's Safe to Share, and Please Ask Your Manager First, something like that. So, might be some childish, but it worked. It worked for them. Use scoped policies. If you know your pilot team, or you know you want to use this with management or HR, use a scoped policy for that. And not try to use the entire global policy to have all those labels in there working for everyone. That's not going to work. Okay, some things on the roadmap then. I already showed you, well, the functionality side of things and then the management side of things. This year is going to bring us a lot of new functionality, for example, integration with the Cloud App Security model. Any of you are familiar with Microsoft Cloud App Security? CAS? Okay, yeah, okay, very good. Look into that. It's a very, very powerful tool. You will need additional licenses for that. You won't recognize it at first, because basically it's bought by Microsoft by a very high-end company, I think in Israel. So. But it's very powerful, and that's going to be integrated with AIP, making it possible to, for example, protect content which isn't stored in like Office 365 or your on-premise environment, but also things like Box. One of the demos at Ignite last September was a document protected when it was stored in a personal Box environment. So look at that as well. Well, I already talked about the scanner. And the 80 more sensitivity types which are coming along. I also talked about the client, and that client is going to be integrated. It's going to be integrated with Office. But, well, more important, I think, it's also going to be integrated with the web, the Office web environment. So right now, you can't, if you start a document in Word online, you can't protect it using AIP. But that's coming in 2018. What's also coming is DLP triggers. Well, what does that mean? Data loss prevention triggers. That's already working if you use AIP combined with the Cloud App Security model. So if you have a policy which says highly confidential information shared with an external party, that's not possible, that shouldn't be possible, then you can set a policy for that so that that document, for example, is being quarantined or a message is going to be sent to the people who sent that document that isn't allowed. That isn't possible with Office 365 right now, but it is possible with the Cloud App Security model and AIP right now, and that's going to be integrated as well. So that's one of the cooler things. Okay, wrapping up, some takeaways. Like I said at the beginning, don't be fooled. AIP is just a piece of that puzzle. You still have to protect your workstations, and you still have to protect your identities, and you still have to use multi-factor authentication, and you name it. You also always need that, but if you want to look at information protection, look at AIP. That's a real powerful solution. Automate some of the things you can automate, like the important stuff. If you have passport numbers, if you have IBAN numbers, if anything, just protect that automatically, because the system is very reliable with that, and basically people don't have to think about, do I need to protect this? Yeah, if it's a passport number, then you have to protect it, and then it will be protected. Also, look at that AIP scanner. To look at what content is already in your organization right now. A couple of years ago, I was at an organization and they started using SharePoint Search. And well, they were very flabbergasted with all the results they got, because they got passport numbers, IBAN numbers, you name it, simply by searching, because the content wasn't protected. AIP can have the same results. So look into that just to see what kind of confidential information is lurking around in your environment. Okay. I guess that's basically what I wanted to show you and wanted to talk about. If you have any more questions or things I wasn't able to show you, then please come to me after this session. I'll probably be at the Société stand, because that's where I work. I try to blog a lot about this subject as well. So if you anything I said today is going to be on the blog as well. So if you're interested, take a look at there. Okay, that's basically it. Thank you very much.